Hello, and welcome back to Family Matters. I'm Dr. Mariana Martinez, your host. Take a moment and think about what has been the most influential group in your life history. Who are the group of people that have, for better or for worse, shaped the person you are today? For most people, the answer is simply, my family. But what about the group of people that are the greatest sources of stress in your life? Family will certainly be near at the top of the list. Family is powerful, and joining me to explore the power of family is my guest, Dr. Robert Noone. Dr. Noone has been a practicing family therapist for more than 40 years, serving as staff and inpatient facility, director of an outpatient alcohol and drug abuse program, and most recently director of a community mental health center in Chicago. Dr. Noone is co-founder of the Center of Family Consultation in Evanston, Illinois, and is currently in private practice in Evanston as well. He's a nationally recognized presenter on Bowen theory and psychotherapy and the author of numerous published articles on the subject. He also serves on the editorial board of Family Systems Journal. Dr. Noone received his Ph.D. at the University of Illinois, Chicago, and did his postgraduate training at the Georgetown University Family Center in Washington, D.C. His research interests have included stress reactivity, the family emotional system, and the interplay between genes and the family during development and over the generations. Dr. Noone, welcome to Family Matters.
Thank you. Glad you asked me to be here.
The power of family. Dr. Noone, how did you got interested in family? And tell us your journey in discovering the power of family.
Well, I didn't seek it out. I think I stumbled into it. I was on my first job. Well, I entered the field, I think, at a very interesting time, a very fortunate time for me. It was in the late 1960s. It was very clear that traditional means of treating emotional illness were not working very well. And in 1963, the Community Mental Health Act was passed. And the effort was to deinstitutionalize people and to keep people out of institutions. So fresh out of school, my first job was working on a unit with chronic schizophrenics who had all been hospitalized for more than 20 years. And the goal was to get them back into the community. And it was just fascinating because you basically stayed on the unit all day long with the individuals who had schizophrenia. And I became very comfortable relating to and being with the most disturbed kinds of individuals in terms of emotional illness. And I was interested in reading their histories and the progress notes that the therapists over 20 years had been writing.
And, 20 years. That's a lot of history.
It's a lot of history. And it struck me that each therapist, and I'm sure out of sincerity, wrote that their patients had been making great progress while they were seeing them. It was pretty clear over 20 years that they were not making progress, but the therapists, of course, would like to be helpful. And I think they were biased in their own efforts to help these individuals. And most of these individuals were had no contact with their family after 20 years. And I found a good number of them really interesting people. We'd have meals with them, talk with them, and they would get psychotic at times, and other times they wouldn't. But the interesting thing was that from there, I was in that program for about 6 months, and the state started a new program out of that hospital. And it was based on a program that had been developed in Colorado by Langsley and Kaplan and Frank Pittman. And the goal was to not let people get into the hospital in the first place, but to provide family therapy in the home as an alternative to hospitalization. It was a well-researched program with 1 year, 3 year, 5 year follow-ups, which showed that the remission rate was much less if you could engage the family rather than institutionalizing someone. So we started this program. I had very little experience. I was chosen as part of the team only because I spoke Spanish. And so the program was began in the inner city in Chicago, mostly in Hispanic area and African American community. And what would happen is family would bring a member into the hospital to be hospitalized. They were either psychotic or suicidal. And we would say, well, we're not going to hospitalize your family member, but we'll meet with you in your home tonight or tomorrow and get as many people in the family that you think would be important to be there. show up and we'll have sessions there in the home.
That was quite a change from here, bring me your patient, he's the one who's got the problem, you're fine, go home.
It was a change. And what was fascinating was these were the same individuals that had been institutionalized for 20 years, at least in terms of their presenting problems. And so it was just fascinating going to people's homes with a person who may be actively psychotic and then engaging the family. I learned for the first time, mostly through an understanding of crisis therapy, to not engage the feeling process, to try to engage the whole family. And in starting out with the problem and then moving towards getting a history of the problem and engaging as many people as possible around what they thought led up to this break of this individual in the family. And sometimes there would be 5 members there, and sometimes there would be 25 family members there. So it was a wide variety.
What's the rationale behind having as many family members as possible?
I think that came out of some original thinking about engaging the larger family as a way of trying to decrease the intensity and to turn the problem over to the family, to not have the institution take up the problem, but to look for as many resources that might be available to the family in the community where that individual lived. So that we, and again, it would be wide range. Usually it was smaller, it would be, but sometimes 8, 10, and usually 2 to 3, sometimes 4 generations would be there. In the part of the city, sometimes you'd have a 3-flat and there'd be 3 generations living in different levels of the building. But what was fascinating was to watch a family very stressed out, very fearful, and this process had built up for some time. And they wanted this member to be cured and taken care of, and they wanted to have the relief of not having that member live with them. So they were not happy to have this member not accepted in the hospital. But it was interesting to watch as they began to talk about and describe what led up to this in this family history, and then talk about what are some of the other things that have been going on in this family, where you'd find out about a death of a grandmother or you'd find out about a job loss, that the family began to calm down. And when the family began to calm down, the psychosis would dissipate without medication. So at that time, I think it's rare to see people treated without medication now who are psychotic.
Right.
But to see this process happen, these same individuals, and we would meet with them for 6 to 8 meetings over a number of weeks, and then encourage them to go to the local community mental health center where they would seek follow-up therapy. But the recidivism rate was very low. Usually these individuals did recover, were able to stay in the family and stay in the community rather than end up in the institution.
So the family was, you sort of discovered in this exercise that the family was important in how others, or at least this individual, was functioning. So people are connected in ways that it's hard to even believe at times.
Yeah, originally when you'd hear about the family, someone being psychotic, they'd go into the hospital, they'd get a little better, they'd go back home, and then get psychotic again. The family was often seen as the source of the problem.
Right.
But if you could engage the family as being a part of the solution, their perspective changed. And I think the perspective of the mental health providers changed when they could see the family was helpful to the patient, and that it wasn't just an individual problem. You could see this process occurring over months and sometimes several years developing that led to this breakup and breakdown, and then the family beginning to come up with some ideas that would be helpful in terms of what they can do about it.
How do you understand the impact of a group over an individual or over another group of individuals? How come one is so permeable or influenced by what the others are going through? If there's a death in the family, how come there's one individual that seems to be reacting to that when the rest of the group is not at least reacting as intensely?
Well, that was one of the questions that got me so interested in family. One, how did this happen? Why was there one person who was more vulnerable? What was it that in the family that led to this breakdown and the family's effort to extrude this member? And then what was it about those individuals who seemed to be take on more of a leadership role in the family, were helpful in the recovery process? So I didn't have an answer to that, and that was one of the things that I've been interested in over these 40 years, is what is it that allows one person to be more vulnerable in a family others to be less vulnerable in the family, and which families are more resilient, have a capacity to recover faster than other families. So I'm still learning about that. But I didn't have a theoretical base either. I didn't really understand it. I could see it happening.
There were just observations by then.
Yeah. And the great family therapist, Carl Whitaker, was a consultant to our group. And so we met with him once a month. And his interest in family and thinking about family therapy really got me interested. So I was sold over a short period of time.
And you have seen it work in your practice.
Yeah. I mean, I didn't start out looking for a family, but once I got into it initially, I realized here's a whole new world that I'm never going to run out of territory in terms of trying to understand and learn about, and including my own family, because I could see patterns operating in these families, but I couldn't see it in my own family. And that picked my interest even more, so I stayed on that course. Mm-hmm. But I think your question about why would some individuals be more vulnerable, I think originally the thinking was that these individuals were scapegoated by the family, that they were projected onto. They were the individuals that the family extruded, rather than seeing them as very intricately connected to the family and a part of it, but vulnerable for a number of different reasons. And since then, of course, I think I became very interested in Bowen theory, and that certainly helped me to understand why one individual might be more vulnerable, or why a particular family would end up with such a severe problem in the family as opposed to other families that were more resourceful.
What makes a family become a resource or become a source of stress? What's the line that divides those families?
Well, that was the other thing. I don't think I understood stress very well at all, but you could literally see, if you could engage the thinking of a family, that they would calm down.
What does that mean? Because I know you use that phrase a lot, and what exactly does that mean, engaging the thinking of the family? As if a family has one brain or what?
Right. Well, the thinking of individuals in the family. So trying to get the family to see this as a problem that could be understood, that they played a part in and that they could do something about, and to begin to ask them questions about the problem, to not assume that the professionals had the answer for it, and to trust that the family could do something about this. So when family members would talk about when did you first start seeing this individual begin to get depressed or begin to isolate himself, and they would describe that, and then what was this person like prior to that? What else was going on in the family during this period of time? So I was asking those how, what, when, where type questions, which engages them in trying to understand what was going on. And as they started thinking, individuals started thinking about this problem and trying to understand it, that by itself helps to calm things down. I think now we know a good deal more about the neurobiology of it in terms of our brains, that when we can engage this executive function, it helps to calm the emotional brain down. It overrides the stress response system. But at that time, that wasn't really known. I think it could be observed in terms of their behavior, but not really understanding what was going on that allowed these individuals to calm down and become to deal with their stress more effectively.
Now, we're talking about families in a very extreme situations with an emotional illness that is pretty severe.
Right.
But how about other families that are apparently less symptomatic or going through less situations less extreme? Are these mechanisms operating as well?
Yeah, I think that's one of the things that was pretty clear. I had heard, I think even before I heard it from Dr. Bowen, that there's a little bit of schizophrenia in all of us. So you can see an extreme version of emotional process in a family with a very impaired family. But when you begin to look at other families who are less impaired, and after working for 3 years doing this family therapy in the home, then I started working on an outpatient basis and seeing less impaired families, and began to see some of the same patterns operating in all families. And eventually, of course, being able to see it in my own family, but that was so close in, it was harder to see. And that's what attracted me to Bowen theory originally, was recognizing the importance of looking at this range of functioning of families, but also trying to see my own part in my own family and try to see the patterns operating in my own family. It bugged me that I was working with families for 6 years and I couldn't really see it in my own family. And I'd heard Dr. Bowen present, and I knew that he was probably the only one who had developed a way to go about trying to understand and work with oneself in relation to one's own family.
Are there families that are more powerful than others, meaning that are there families that tend to be more or impact more the individual functioning of its members, and other groups that the way they organize allow them to be less impacted by the relationship?
Yeah, well, that's an interesting question. I think so. I think there, well, some families have a longer history of difficulties. And you can see this when you get some history, that over three generations, for example, the family really struggled and they had all kinds of difficulties. It was more of a chaotic family. They would tend to develop difficulties under mild stress. And other families would be more in better contact with one another, seem to manage stress well, and it may have been a number of stressors that came together in a very intense period of time that resulted in a breakdown. But I think the capacity of a family to stay intact and to be able to manage stress well is something that varies a good deal among families. And what makes the difference? I think that's where you get back into the multi-generational family history, as well as the environment in the present in terms of how stressful it is.
One of the areas of your research is on the family as a unit. And how do you describe that? What does that mean, that the family is a unit, and where does the power of the family comes from?
Well, I think, again, that's something that I could see early on, that the family that lived together, this unit, was wired together, and it was difficult to describe. You could think of it as a communication system. I didn't understand it as an emotional system, but it was clear that their behaviors influenced each other. There were so many stunning examples of watching this happen in visiting families in their home, but there was one family early on that still remains very vivid, and there were a number of other ones, but I'll use that as an example. And the family had wanted this, he was about 24, had retired to his bedroom, had not left in 6 months, didn't talk. He had long hair, his fingernails were very long. He was not communicating with anybody, isolated himself. And the family wanted to bring him to the hospital to admit him. And we said, no, we'll meet with you in the home. And this was a Mexican-American family. We met with them in their home. I went into the bedroom where he was. It was dark in there. He didn't say a word to me. I talked to him. I told him what I understood was the difficulty and that we were there to see if we could be of any help to the family. Well, his bedroom was just off the kitchen, and so we sat down with the family to talk about what had happened and to get their view of it. And why at this point in time did they seek help? And usually there's a reason why at this particular time.
Right, why in 6 months, why not before, right?
And it was the oldest daughter who wanted to get married, but she said she couldn't leave the mother with this problem. And so she was not getting married. And mother said, you have to live your life. But she didn't want to leave the mother, so they decided they would have the son hospitalized, and then they could go forward with the family wedding. Well, in getting the family history, we left the bedroom door open so that the son could hear what we were talking about. We met with the family about six times. Mother was a great cook. We even had dinner with her. She prepared meals for us and got to know the family well, reasonably well, and got a history. The father had been murdered about a year and a half before this incident where the son retired to his room. After about five meetings, the next time we went to meet with the family, the son wasn't there. And we said, what happened? And he said, 3 days ago, he came out of his room and he came up to me, this is mother, and said, can you give me some money for a haircut? He went and got a haircut. He went out and looked for a job and got a job. It was just a remarkable shift. So he was working. And this is after probably 7 or 8 months of just isolating himself and apparently being psychotic, but he pulled out of it, and the family then began to move forward. So those kinds of things really...
I mean, that's a pretty dramatic story. And how do you understand how the family had, what the family had to do with it all?
Well, I think the oldest daughter began to make some decisions for her own life. The family was, you asked about being a unit, and this family was very stuck together. We're fearful that mother couldn't manage with the son. And daughter began to make a decision, okay, I'm going to move forward in my life. I'm not going to allow my brother to dictate my future. And she did make a decision to move forward, and mother was very supportive of it. Once that family started moving together as a unit, it was an individual who took a leadership position and moved forward. But that seemed to shift the unit and its functioning. And how that happened with that individual, I don't know. But I think that his symptoms served a function for the family in keeping the family together, particularly after the death of the father. And they had not recovered from that. They stayed in this stuck together mode. And then once someone started moving forward, the family started to recover.
So in that case, it's very clear that the family was a resource to this individual and to everybody else as well,
right.
To this other sister who was stuck and couldn't get married because of the brother. So
right.
Each other, they were a resource to each other in a way.
Yeah.
How does one switch from having a family that you conceive as the source of your stress to the source of your resource?
I don't think everyone can do that. I think you have to get to a place where you become curious about it. I think it is, it takes a certain motivation to begin to, and I think a certain belief that this family can make a difference in one's life, that it is a part of the problem, but it is a problem that everyone is dealing with. And if you can move in the direction of the family instead of trying to move away from the family, you can learn more about yourself and then begin to get some of the resources that the family provides. Learn more about oneself in the process.
So whether we want it or not, our family is powerful. And
yeah.
it has power on us in a way.
Yeah.
So we can either run away from it and try to hide under a rock and we'll be found. Or face it and learn about it. And you say get curious. Tell me more about that, getting curious. What do you mean?
I think it's different for different people. I know that watching someone decompensate or go through a difficult time and then begin to recognize, okay, what led up to this? So you can see the problem as being within the individual, related to their personality and the stress in that person's life, and maybe they see the family as the cause of that problem. Or you can see that family as a part of a unit.
That individual, rather.
Mm-hmm. As an interdependent element in this family. And if you can begin to recognize that this isn't a problem that's just in the individual, it's a problem in the unit. And if you can begin to see that, it takes pressure off the individual, for one thing. But also recognizes that how did this develop over a period of time? I think it allows someone to become a little more objective about what led up to this difficulty. And it gets back to being able to use one's cognitive function to begin to assess the problem and begin to understand it more effectively. And I think one of the major sources of difficulties when symptoms develop for individuals, it is usually related to a combination of being isolated and being stressed. So even someone living in a family may become very isolated within that family, and they are going through a period of stress. Or the family may become very isolated and are going through a period of stress, and then a symptom can develop. So when an individual can begin to move to operate differently in the family and to be less reactive, less concerned about seeing the family as the problem, but curious about how did I get here, or how did this family get here? It really opens up a number of options for people to begin to think about it differently.
Well, I think that's a question that can be very useful as a startup. If you people that are watching are interested in learning a little bit about their families and this, how do I start in this journey? That might be one of the questions. how come I'm in this place at this time and what led to it? And that's a good start to understand the power of the family for an individual, I guess.
Yeah, and over the years, individual after individual and family after family, it is remarkable to see an individual come in with a specific view about their difficulty, or a couple, or parents concerned about a child, and then begin to ask questions about the family and the individuals. And as they begin to think about it, as the view of the family begins to expand, they get more curious and they begin to start thinking about some options that they might try that they hadn't tried before.
And then they can go and make some t-shirts for themselves with a PF, the power of the family. And we'll stop there. Dr. Noone, okay. Thank you for being with us today. It was very useful.
You're welcome. Thank you.
I'd like to remind you that the Bowen Center for the Study of the Family offers a community affordable psychotherapy in both English and Spanish. If you would like more information about our topic or the services at the Bowen Center, please visit the website at www.thebowencenter.org or send me an email at familymatters@thebowencenter.org. You can find us on Facebook or call 202-965-4400. Thank you for watching, and I invite you to join me again for another edition of Family Matters. I'm Dr. Mariana Martinez, and your family does matter.
And microphones are dead, but you're still
no. We keep talking.